Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, for what you're going to do today, Lord God. We lift up the worship to you, God. We lift up, Father God, every single man, woman, and child that's here today, Lord God. It is your day to be glorified, God, in Jesus' mighty name. Living Word Family says amen and amen. Come on, church, give it up for Jesus as we get ready to praise and worship Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah.
Good morning, everyone. We're right now having technical difficulty right now, but just go ahead and let's give Jesus a shout of praise this morning. Amen. Woo! Come on, who's excited to be in the house of God? Amen. Hallelujah. So let's all stand. Amen. Come on, let's get excited. Amen. Let me hear those hands clapping.
Glorious. Shout it out in glorious. Make it louder. Jesus, we shout your name. Jesus, we make your praise glorious. Jesus, you
Come on, church. Open your hearts unto the Lord this morning. Amen. Let's give God glory. Let's give Him honor.
As we wait, seek Your face. Come and make Your throne upon our praise. Here in this place, have Your way. The moment that we see You, we are changed.
Blessed this year. Just the fact that you have air in your lungs is a blessing. Amen. Let's give God a shout of praise. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
We ask the church to join us in prayer. Amen. Join us in worship this morning.
Come on. Change, fall, fear.
Hallelujah. Come on, church. Stay excited. Amen. Give it up for the worship team. I don't know about you, but I'm excited. Amen. What a day. Amen. It is. Amen. Hallelujah. Want to welcome everybody once again to our New Year's Eve celebration service right here in Upland. Amen. Give Jesus one more big hand clap. We're going to go ahead and open up to the second part of prayer. Amen. Heavenly Father, we just come before you, Lord God, thanking you, Lord God, just for everything, Lord God, that you have given us, Lord God. You gave us your son, Jesus Christ, Lord God, to die for us, Lord God. And we're so grateful and so thankful, Lord God, that you, Father God, are just ministering, Father God, to our hearts, Lord God, every single day, Lord God, as we wake up, Lord God, until we go to sleep, Lord God, that you have covered us, Lord God, that you have put your wings of protection around us, God. And we just ask you, Lord God, to fill us up with your holy presence, Lord God, because you have no rival, you have no equal. Lord God, and there's no one greater, Father God, than you, Lord God. We just want to give you, Lord God, all the praise and the mighty glory in Jesus' mighty name. Living Word says, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Come on, church, give it up one more time. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus. As we get ready for our announcements, we may go ahead and be seated in the presence of the Lord.
Amen, church. All right, so we have a few announcements, but who's excited to be here this morning? Amen. Man, it's going to be an awesome time, and just our first announcement is if we could please put our phones on silent or vibrate, just so we don't get interrupted during what's taking place, and I know we're all fellowshipping and stuff, so you don't have to be on your phone. Take a minute to talk to one another and just fellowship in the Lord. Amen? Okay. And also, if you see a reserved parking space, please do not park there, or there will be a message on the screen letting you know. And another announcement is we want to keep on inviting people to the service. I know a lot of people are here to, you know, just thank you for coming. And on Christmas Eve, let's not forget that, you know, we celebrate this time of year, celebrating the birth of Christ, our Lord and Savior. And so let's not forget, you know, let's hold that through the year and just keep letting people know that he's the reason for all the celebration. And he's the real reason behind every day for being thankful and for just being happy in him. So we want to keep on inviting people out to our services on Wednesday nights and Sundays. You know, pack this place out and let them know that our pastor has a really good message for everyone. For we want to keep bringing people and making disciples of nations. And I believe that's all the announcements I have right. Oh, and there's going to be fellowship, and everyone's going to stick around. You know, you smell the food and the tables. If you're wondering what's going on here, that's what's going to happen. So stick around and just you know, be thankful for what the Lord's done for you in this time of year. All right, as we call up Brother Anthony for the tithes and offerings. Amen. Let's give a hand clap for the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Can we give the Lord some praise right now? Amen. Someone say Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for another day. My gosh. Man, this is the day the Lord has made. Let's be grateful today for this gathering. Amen. We're about to get back to the Lord right now. If we call our ushers up. Amen. It's so different up here right now. But amen. Thank you, Lord, for another day. All right. We have three ways to give, church. You can tell your neighbor once again, thank God for Zelle. Amen. And that number is 909-303-0291. And if you'd like to write a check out to Living Word Upland, you may. And we have through our tithing envelopes. Just a show of hand if anyone needs a tithing envelope today. Amen. Amen. Now we're going to get into scripture right now. It's right here off of John chapter 3, verse 16. And it says right here, for God so loved the world that he gave. his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Amen? Amen. Amen. I mean, so Christmas is like the biggest day everyone gives away, right? Yeah. Amen? It's like the biggest day ever. But we know it's also the day that our Father in heaven gave his son, amen? Which we can never pay back, amen? That's the greatest gift we could ever get, amen? If we gave our whole bank account, if we gave our kids away, if we gave everything off our back, amen? Amen? There's nothing we could do to pay back our Heavenly Father, amen? Man, look at this. This is a blessing right here at church for all of us to be in the house of the Lord, amen? Amen? Amen. God is good, amen? And you know what? He gave his best, so he deserves our best, amen? You know, God doesn't deserve our leftovers, amen? You know, when we try to give our kids our leftovers from yesterday, amen? No, that's not how we do it here. We give God our best, amen? He deserves our best to show him what he means to us, amen? Our God is good. No, I'm lying. God is great, amen? Our God is so great, amen? Amen, and you know, he just blessed us in this gathering right here. Everyone, I want you to have a blessed day. Grub up. We're going to watch your kids today. They're going to be blessed. Amen? Amen. All right, if we could all just pray over the tithes and offerings right now. Yes, Heavenly Father, my God. Father God, my Lord, we come to you one mind, one accord to show you reverence, my Lord. My God, we come to pay you respect, my God, for everything that you give, my God. Everything that you do in our lives, my God. Where you pulled us out of, my God. For your patience and mercies, which are new every single day, my Lord. We thank you, my God. Let us come to you, my God, with a full heart of gratitude, my Lord. My God, we ask that you touch the minds and hearts, my God. And we ask that you bring peace to our souls today, my God. For anyone who is going through chaos, my God. You are the only one that brings peace in the storm, my Lord. And my God, we praise you today, my God. We lift your holy name up today, my God. My God, we ask that you cover this gathering, my God, the households, my God, all the tomorrow and Christmas, my God, the New Year's, and the days you're going to bless us with in the future, my God. We ask that you just cover, my God. My God, we love you, my God. Once again, we lift your holy name up in this place. In Jesus, my name, our church says, amen and amen.
Amen. Like Anthony was, you know, talking about, you know, the enemy is always in attack mode when you're planning something. Could I get an amen? Amen. But how many of us know he still has no authority, right? But today, you know, as we continue on, we have a special blessing as they're coming and they're making their way up right now. Hannah and Rachel.
So this first song, I just kind of wanted to share with you guys in honor of Christmas and the birth of Jesus. So the three songs that we're doing are about the birth of Jesus. But this first song, it talks about, it's called What Child Is This? And it talks about Jesus as a baby sleeping on Mary's lap. And I just think, I mean, he's the lion and the lamb, right? So we have this mighty God. And then we have this innocent little baby, you know, that delivered us from sin. And thinking about him just as a baby sleeping on Mary's lap, I think is the most beautiful picture of innocence that there is. And this is just a song to kind of honor that. So it's not going to be perfect, but thanks for being here today.
Named Mary was visited by an angel named Gabriel. The angel told Mary that she would have a son named Jesus who would be God's son. At this time, Mary was engaged to her soon-to-be husband, Joseph. When told, Joseph was hurt and confused because he did not believe Mary. But the angel Gabriel visited Joseph and told him, "Do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit and is her son, Jesus, who would save the people from their sins."
Son. Thank you. That's everything. Thank you guys for coming.
Hallelujah. Can we get more songs? All right, let's give them another clap offering, amen. How many of us know God is good, right? And right now, we may be seated in the presence of the Lord. And like I said today, I wasn't going to keep everybody long. If we can get the lights on already, we're going to go ahead and dismiss our children right now into the class. And like I said, nobody be in a hurry. We could even turn on the other lights as well. If there's a light switch over there, Anthony, or someone grab it. Because I want to see everybody. Hallelujah. Tell everybody right now that's sitting across, Merry Christmas. Amen. But again, how many are excited to be in the house of God? Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm excited as well. Amen. I said we're going to go ahead and do just a little fast Christmas service, you know, that way we can get done. So I kind of light a little bit so I can get you guys to come out, okay? Hello? Everybody? But right now, as we get started with the service today, you know, I just wanted to share like a few minutes and the understanding of what the purpose of Christmas really is, you know. And right now, as we can look at, I got to run into Jesus the other day. You guys want to look at him, all right? He actually did a video for us. It's a real fast little clip. Watch, look. He's on his way. Choo-choos. Or look. For those who know him, that's Michael Bouchard.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Hey, when I seen it, I said, oh my God. He does have a little resemblance of him, right? For those that know him, that's Michael Bouchard. He's at our pastor, our mother church, and he actually lives in the back, him and his wife, in the back of the men's home. You know, they live out there. But, you know, I was like, I tripped out on the video. I said, whoa, he came the other day. I just talked to him. Amen. But right now, I'm going to go ahead and just jump into the scripture, Matthew chapter 1, verse 20 to 22. And like understanding the purpose of Christmas, the word of God reads like this. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said to Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to make Mary's home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, today, Father God, for your presence, Father God, in this house. Open up our hearts, Father God, and let us just be able to receive, Father God, all the gifts, Lord, that you give us, Lord. But always giving you the praise, the honor, and the mighty glory. In Jesus' name we say, amen and amen. Let's give a clap offering to the Lord today. You know, as we enter the Christmas season, for most of us would be amazed at the large number of people who could not tell us what the true meaning of Christ is. A lot of times when we understand this, you know, for some of us, it is a season where we can be together with family. There's some seasons, too, that we can be lost of a family. Amen. You know, there's all sorts of different areas that are happening that sometimes in these holidays will not be the same like others. But still, when we understand that Christmas, it was a gift that God given us, amen. As right now we read in the scripture, it says she will give birth to a son And you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Meaning that as we're, you know, Christians, you know, we all fall short of the glory. So we needed a savior in our life. We needed someone to birth in our lives, you know, to be birthed in our lives for our sin, because the Bible says that God despises sin. And for us, you know, that's the miracle that it was. It was the birth of Jesus, that God had gave his promise to every believer that will believe, that now that we have salvation through the death of Jesus. But Jesus first had to be born. Tell your neighbor, that's what Christmas is about, Jesus' birthday. So now Christmas to many is simply a winter holiday. Amen. With Santa Claus coming down the chimney, but that's not the real Christmas. Could I get an amen? But therefore, it is our duty as Christians, and I believe this, you know, as believers of Christ, just leave it off, as believers of Christ, that we have to show our children, turn it off. We got too much light, just shut them off. Yeah, at least these ones. There we go. So as believers, you know, our duty is to teach our children, to teach our children about, you know, the love of Jesus, what he did, you know, for many of us. Amen. And we're talking over 2,000 years ago. Amen. So our duty as Christians, the church, is to teach the children and our world that Christmas is a celebration of the birth of Christ. Tell your neighbor, that's good. I say, man, I got to get rid of my Santa Claus suit. Amen. But also, it's to sing about the birth. We just heard the songs right now, the hymns, you know, for the Lord. Amen. And what the story it is. But again, can you just imagine when the angel spoke of the purpose of Christmas when informing Joseph of the name the baby should be called? Jesus was simply means deliverer or savior. So now, to fully understand the purpose of Christmas, we must go back even further than the first Christmas morning. Our announcement is of the birth, or even the prophecies of the birth, amen. Because it was prophesied in the Old Testament that there will be a Savior. And that's where the Savior was the promise that was back even from the beginning, when God began to see how people's hearts were turning away from him. And for those that know, in the Old Testament, we lived by the law of Moses. Those were the Ten Commandments, amen. Or I think it was the 12 ones, right? The one that Pastor Ruben Reyna always tells us, the last one, don't be stupid, amen? And in reality, you have to understand that we have a purpose in our life. That's why we belong to am I around believers today? Amen? Hallelujah. You know, we have a purpose for our life. Our purpose is not to fulfill the earth, because when we have a more clear understanding of our purpose here in this life, the Bible clearly states that our life here is not where it ends. We have an eternal life that what the Savior did, Jesus, on his birthday, amen, until he hit the resurrection part where he was brought. But like I said, it was the gift that God gave us that's the ultimate gift. Could I get an amen? Oh, let's give a clap offering for the Lord. You see, number one, God's great design for man. In Genesis 1:26, it says, then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, over the livestock, and all the wild animals, amen, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. In the creation account, we find that man and woman was God's crown jewel.
of all creation, meaning that everything that God created, he wanted man and woman to rule over them. Could I get an amen? Amen. And that's the way God had designed us. But understanding again, you know, through sin, you know, when Adam and Eve, they were in the Garden of Gethsemane, you know, when they said, you know, they were told, don't eat from that fruit. Amen. Tell your neighbor, don't eat from that fruit. So curious, you know how we get sometimes. Can you imagine if they tell you don't do it? How do we get? What would happen? Well, there was the deceivement that took place. And that was when Eva took a bite out of it. Nothing happened, right? But what did God tell the man? Don't eat from it. Until he ate, it's when they opened their eyes. And it was always blaming someone else, amen? But thank God for Jesus, amen, for what he did. So God created man in his image. You know, as we understand what God is holy, amen? He's not like us. We probably got a holy sock on us today, amen? That's about the only holy thing that we're wearing today, amen? But you got to understand that God, if God created us in his image, then that means that we have our part that he wants us to walk in righteousness. Many of us as believers, that we say we're believers, sometimes we don't engage. And that's where sometimes it gets scary. That's why we have to teach our children. Tell your neighbor, we got to teach our children. Nephews, nieces, moms, dads, whoever it is that don't believe, we have to teach them about the love of Christ, what God really represents, amen, what Jesus really represents. So, in other words, God created man in his image to be holy, to have our own will. In understanding what our own will is, that means that you get to decide if you want to serve God or if you want to serve the other God. The Bible clearly states that there's only two that you can serve. You're either going to serve darkness or you're going to serve light. Many of us get stuck in being deceived of not lack of understanding. But we understand certain things. You know, when the frijoles hitting the manteca with water, what does it do? When the beans hit the grease with water, or any water hits the grease, it pops. And that's what it is. That's what happens. Many of us, when we start to understand, well, wait a minute. That means that darkness and light don't go together. If you have light, it should brighten up everything, amen? That means that if you have Christ in you, amen? Because now as we receive him, you know, the Bible says that there be light, amen? Light to be able to show to your children, to show to your grandchildren, to show to people around you. Tell your neighbor, don't be a people pleaser. Be a Jesus pleaser. Oh, come on. You can get excited. I'd rather please Jesus than anything, because why? It's my eternal life. Let me ask you a quick, simple question. How many want to go to hell? I don't see no hands raised up. One more time. How many want to go to hell? How many want to go to heaven? Okay, the Bible says that we're going to feast. What are we going to do today? Hallelujah, praise God. We're catching it. Amen. So then God created man to enjoy the relationships and the fellowship. You see, some of us say, okay, I'm going to go to heaven and all that. And yeah, we're going to fellowship up there when we get in heaven. But you can't even fellowship here. Ouch. Amen. That's a free 99. Amen. So you understand, God created man, being given man alone a body, soul, and spirit. God created man uniquely in a way to commune with himself through the spirit of man. God created man to have dominion over the earth. Man is not just another part of some evolution or how you ever say process, but was created for the purpose of having dominion over all God's creation. Could I get an amen? An amen. Sorry, my Spanish is coming out. But not did only God create man, his most special creation, he also placed man and woman in a perfect environment. Amen. That's when we talked about the Garden of Eden. As we examine Eden, it was really a heaven on earth. When you think about it, if God already, that means that man and woman didn't have to face death no more. That means that it was all done. God said, look, I'm going to create, you know, here so you guys could just have dominion of the earth. But due to the lack of sin, tell your neighbor, lack of sin. You know what you just did yesterday? Oh, man, I need to repent. Amen. But understanding this, can you imagine living in an environment that it was so pleasing? I mean, now, of course, our heavens that are being promised to us is that we're going to be walking in the streets of gold. Amen? Yeah. Some of you are going to be going like this. Ooh, could I make a gold chain off this one? Amen? Wearing a big old bling bling out there with your little wings. Amen? Hey, Pat. You know, hey, where'd you get that? Oh, from the streets. Man, they're everywhere. But understanding that, just to imagine in a place of a perfect environment, a place not too hot, hello somebody, or not too cold, a place with lush vegetation, although there never rained, a place where there was no shortage of food. But best of everything, can you imagine living in a place where there was perfect harmony between man and man, man and woman, and everything, and beast, and even beast and beast. As we see right now, you know, everybody can get aggressive with somebody. Could I get an amen? Just look at your neighbor real slow and say, stop looking at me like that. Amen. And then they'll look at you like, don't look at Ray. Amen. Because he'll look at you cross-eyed and then you can't stop laughing. Amen. That's the cowboy hat right here. Amen. I say, oh, my God, he makes me laugh. And then I'm seeing it. He's looking at everybody cross-eyed. Amen. You can't do nothing, but if you're mad, you're just going to laugh now. Amen. But can you imagine a place where there is no worry, no care, because you have total assurance that God will provide everything from you? I believe that many of us, you know, go through seasons in life, struggles in life. You know, believe me, we've been there, done that, amen, lots of times. And, you know, maybe it's a season in your life that you're stuck at. But still, you know, this is why we say, you know, that why the birth of Jesus is so important, because it gives us salvation. Could I get an amen? And then for number two, you know, we hear man's tragic fall from God's plan. You know, God, you know, remember, he wanted it the best. And you know how we can get disobedient? Anybody here ever been disobedient? Hallelujah. Okay, I only see like five hands out. Amen. Come on. Okay, let me tell you like this. The ones that raise up your hands, look at your neighbors that didn't raise your hand. Those are the ones. Watch it. Amen. Everybody don't want to say, no, hey, Pastor, it's Christmas. Well, Santa Claus knows if you were naughty or nice. Hello, somebody. That's you, Jesus. Amen. You're getting it right now. But then again, the fall of man. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals. Amen. And the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did you go really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat from the fruit of the trees of the garden. But God did say, not that one. Amen. See, it was a woman's fault. Tell your neighbor, it was a woman's fault. Nah, it was a man. He bit, okay? He felt, I'm going to say, he felt a little suckered for the woman, amen. Okay, it's all right. I'd do it for my wife, amen. And then I tell God, it's the one you gave me, amen. It was her fault, amen. But, you know, sin tarnished man's character. It tarnished it. You know, Romans 5:12 says, therefore, just as through one man's sin, one man, tell your neighbor, one man, sin entered the world and death came behind it through sin. And thus death spread to all men because all sin now. So sin corrupted the will of God's for man. Not only was man's character tarnished, but when sin entered the man will became corrupted. Man's decision-making process became like screwed up, amen, with the effects of sin. And Adam was created. He was given a free will. Tell your neighbor, oh, here we go, free will. To decide between right and wrong. You see, that's the loving God that we serve. God is not going to force you to him. God wants you to say, I want you, Lord. Amen. Oh, come on. If you can get excited. God wants you to say, I want to serve you, God. My will, I understand, Lord, that you have a will and a purpose for my life. It's a will not to harm me. It's a will to give me life eternity. I accept your son, Jesus Christ, as my Lord and Savior, because that's the only way that God says, I'm going to give you my son. To die for you. That's what he's giving us. But again, let's go. The entrance of sin. Man's will is no longer free, as all decisions might be processed through a sinful heart. For example, immediately after Adam's sin, his decision-making ability became tarnished, and he became bent to make bad decisions. What did he do? Immediately he hid himself. Amen. Remember the story of Adam and Eve? He hid himself, and then when he hit the apple, he looked at his wife. He said, oh my God. And they have banana leaves all over the place. Amen. So immediately when God was coming on the Garden of Eden, he was calling for them. Instead of, immediately when he did, he hid himself instead of seeking God for help. You know, when many of us, when we're going, you know, maybe are going through struggles in life, and a lot of times, sometimes we separate ourselves. You know, I've been there, done that. You know, I separated myself. But what God was seeing, instead of me going towards him to get healed, that's why he's saying, my son and daughter, okay, you know what, just come to me. Amen. But here, as an example, Adam hid himself. He began to make excuses. Sound familiar? None of us here make excuses, right? Oh, no. Why? I'm on a holy church, amen, because not that many. Everybody here. That means, oh, you shouldn't have an excuse why I don't come to church. Huh? Is that an excuse? Well, Pastor, I got to go to Disneyland. Must be nice. But we always have excuses for why we don't do what we need to do. Again, how many want to go to heaven? Tell your neighbor then. Tell yourself. Stop making excuses then. Amen? They're like belly buns. They all stink. Amen? Hey, we're making a comedy Christian Christmas, amen? Oh, come on, you can give the Lord a clap offering. In Isaiah 59:2 says, but your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you, so that he will not hear. I don't know about you, but, you know, I've been in my worst days in my life. Me and my wife, my children that are here, they've seen a lot of stuff. And I understand it, man. You know, it was hurtful because I understand how deep and how hard it was to finally just surrender my life. You know, me and my wife, we just said we're done. You know, and it was so hard because why? We lived a life. We lived a life of maybe doing things that we shouldn't be doing. I mean, we were only normal. Some people might think, oh, they're the pastors and, you know, they're holy and all that. We still have our problems. And not only that, everybody else's that come with it. But it's all good because we understand that we serve a loving God, a God that's not going to leave us nor forsake us. Amen. My thing is that I understand now is that even through the corruption or everything, the best thing that we can do is always pray. Tell your neighbor, pray. Because if you pray, you stay. You even hear the baby already say, pray. Amen. Hey, remember, those are God's first chosen. The little ones. Why? Because as a child, their heart is so pure. Amen. Whatever you tell a child, you tell them, hey, you better not be bad. Because Santa Claus is not going to leave you no Christmas presents. I know what. Ooh, I better be on my A's and Q's, right? What did mom always tell you? Pray. Pray. Because if pray that I don't hit you, amen. My mom's back there, amen. Pray that I don't hit you. Give you a bofetada or something. Okay, I'm praying, amen. And then how about the one where they tell you, hey, you don't be messing around. It's, you know, la llorona's going to take you at night. At nighttime, you're like, and then you hear a cat, meow. Oh, she's outside. Go to sleep. I think my mom used to tell me that hey, if you don't go to sleep by a certain time, the llorona would be there. And then sometimes I'm like, I'm going to stay up a little bit later. And then I hear a cat in. I'm going to go see what it is. It was good stuff, amen. But you know, there it is, amen. But man traded eternal life for eternal damnation, amen. It's not a bad word, amen. It's in the Bible. Discredited, found guilty, and disapproved, rejected. But here, the main one that I just want to get out. But God's redeeming purpose of Christmas, Matthew 1:21, it says, and she will bring forth a son, and you shall call him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. You see, God sent his son to regenerate man's character. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. For he made him know. This is in 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we may become the righteousness of God in him. Meaning that Jesus took every sin of this world to nail it to the cross for you and I. That's what his purpose was here in this earth, to save his people, God's people. So God says, I'm gonna give you my son to die in your place, so that way if you believe and you follow what I'm giving you in the understanding that you will be saved, and not only you but your family will be saved. I don't know about you, that's some good news, amen. But can you imagine God giving his only son? I know some of you says, hey, he can take mine. I know my mom would be saying that, amen. You know, some of you, oh, yeah, take them now, Lord. Hey, go here. Go ahead. Hey, bro, you're going to have to go. Amen. But in reality, think about it. Jesus had no sin. There was no tarnish. There was nothing on him. But everything fell on him on that cross when he took that place of us. And then the gift, he says, this is all. You don't have to do the Ten Commandments. Because I know some of us always want to do, well, I do the Ten Commandments. Okay, well, okay, good for you. But, you know, the Bible says it fails. I mean, if you try to start reading them. So in reality, there's nothing righteous about our life. The only thing that is righteous is Jesus Christ when he's in our life. And then, yes, of course, we start to work and activate the faith that we believe in. And this is how God begins to do things in our life, where we'll be able to even teach people about the good news of Jesus Christ. So what God did, he renewed man's will. He restored man's relationship. He reclaimed man's dominion. And he redirected man's eternity. Let's give the Lord a clap offering. Amen. Right now, that's the true meaning of Christmas. Amen. And now you can all give me a present. Amen. Hallelujah. I was good, Santa Claus. Not Jesus, you know, too. But in reality, right now, we're going to get ready. I don't know how we're going to do it right now. We're going to start serving food. We're not going to keep everybody here too long. I believe we're going to try to serve the kids first. Get the kids first. My wife's coming up here, the sergeant. Hallelujah. What did I do wrong? She's almost getting pulled. You got to